toughest time of my life, I think, started kind of right here. This is where when my parents split. My mother, my aunt lived in this house. My aunt Pam, rest in peace. My cousin Ali and Poopy and my family. This is Baldwin Hills Elementary School right here in the park. My dad used to open that gym. We had keys to all the gyms because my dad worked for the city of Los Angeles. But the toughest part of my life, I think, started pretty much right here, man. I think I was a little lost. I was a lot lost. But my parents, we had went from that beautiful home on 81st, and we went through just so much to living in this garage. Me and my mom, my sister, we slept there, ate in the house and everything. But my mother was so, she didn't want to bother anybody. She was trying to figure it all out. And we lived here with my aunt. My aunt didn't make us live in the garage. It was just my mother was like, hey, I don't want to be anybody's way. I don't want to be a burden. And so we stayed here. And I remember my parents, I think that was like April that they had split. The end of the school year, after Easter, we're dealing with everything. So that summer, this is where I was at. And I was at that park every single day. That was my deal. Like, I'd get up and go to that park, and I'd play ball. I used to have a rocket ship over there, and I'd go to the rocket ship. And I think this is probably one of the very, very first places that I really start talking to God about life. I was 14 years old, 13, turning 14. I'm in a garage. My dad had just, you know, was just in the other room, like, to me, just yesterday. And we're living here. And we go in the house, brush our teeth, shower, do all that stuff, come back to the garage, get dressed. My mom goes to work. My sister goes to my Aunt Regina's house. And I had a lot of alone time. And so this is where that alone time happened, at that park. We used to eat lunch at the park. And we break in the school cafeteria right here. Me, my cousin Ali, and y'all might know, kind of funny story, Ty Bridges grew up in Baldwin. So me, Ali, Ty Bridges, all of us, we break into there. So Ty's been a bad guy for a long time, but cool with me. And we would break in the, I don't know, people young enough or old enough to remember Ty Bridges. What you talking about, Willis? Willis. So we used to break in the Baldwin Hills and take the lunch. But it was just stuff that we did. It wasn't like we did it because we were hungry or nothing. It was just something to do. And then we play basketball, caroms, do whatever all day. But I would get up, my mother would leave me a little bit of money, and I walk from here down to, what is that? Is that Sepulveda? Yeah, Sepulveda. And I'd go eat at Carl's Jr., wait till kids get to the park. And I was a bit of a loner at that time, but I remember talking to God a lot, like, what is this about? What's going on? Like, my life. But this was a tough part, man. Like, really, really, people didn't know. And it's probably one of the reasons that I'm not all about the floss. Like, my mother didn't want people to know that we were in the garage. So it was a big floss. It was like, oh, we live in Baldwin Hills. No, we live in a garage in Baldwin. We don't live in Baldwin Hills. You know what I mean? Like, we in the garage. To me, that's how it was. And but again, mentors of my life, man. I'd go to that park every day. Guys, y'all know Cal Supreme coach. He's only probably 2 years older than me, maybe 3 years, Gary Franklin. And he was a man to me because I was such a young boy. I was 13. He was probably 16, 17 years old. And he used to be one of the counselors. And he laughed to this day. He said, man, you used to come up here and terrorize people. And I was like, I didn't. I used to just come play basketball. But I wasn't fortunate to be a part of the summer program. You know, I don't know if it costs money or whatever, and we just didn't have it. And so, you know, for me, life drastically changed at this particular point. But I never chided my mother and my father for it. It just became like the the part of my life when I look back to make me better. You know, it made me better. I was upset by it at times, but I went, this is what makes me strong. So I guess this is why I can live. If I can live in a garage, I can live anywhere. Some people sleep in cars, they don't sleep outside. I think for me, it just was the drastic change. Like the house you guys saw on 81st, the dad, my football coach, and we just, you know, that life. I think my wife was saying the other day, like, you've had some trauma. You know, and I guess, man, for me to come out on this other side the way, you know, I have, to see 50 and all the people that have died along the way, it's a crazy journey, but I will say God can all day. God can. So here, you know, kind of rough moving from Baldwin Hills garage, you know, or Baldwin Hills, out of the garage of my aunt's house to my great aunt's house to 8th Ave and 50th, man. This was our first place that me, my mom, my sister, we stayed in the back house that was created. It was like a little studio, but we were just so happy, man, that we were out of another situation. My dad was still coming by, you know, really to make reference to that, man. I want to make sure people know that I didn't have that story of like my dad wasn't around. He was around. I was with my pops every weekend. I played basketball with him. We still talked and different things, but our lives had just drastically changed from, you know, from being over there on 81st to like the All-American family, my mom, cheer mom, my dad, football coach, to a life that was just totally, just different. It was so different not having him in the next room. And I never knew that through ministry or whatever that I was doing as far as motivational speaking or working with young people, that the two parts of my life in my life would be so prevalent in today and how I deal with kids, and from every different background of going to camp and dealing with different cultures or whatever it may be, and through my travels of playing basketball, working as a sports agent, doing stand-up comedy, whatever it was, like all of this stuff was relevant to that. But really tough part, man, like if we look down the street, I went to Audubon Junior High by the time I went and moved to this house. And down there, you got this is 50th, so that's 48th, and that's Vernon. And so when you start talking about the gang lines in the 80s, my cousin Junebug was from 40s, and they down there by Vernon. And then we like rolling 50 bloods. My man Levy lived on the corner, Sugar Hill Will, and his family, like they was bloods. And so my walk home from school was crazy, because you had to figure out like who was I, like what set was I gonna be from, like, you know what I mean? And it was like I was more afraid of my dad than I was any gang member, so I wasn't gang banging. But I played basketball, and nobody bothered me because of that, and like I didn't have that affiliation. And that's what made this school, like Crenshaw High, so great to me. And Coach Willie West, and when people don't know like what you were going through in the house, you know, that I was going through those different things that was happening with my dad, my mom, with the drugs or whatever it may be. It was like the Lakers and Crenshaw High basketball. I knew nothing about college basketball. That wasn't it. I knew Stevie Thompson, David Carter, Deion Brown, Courtney Abel, like Kemo Patrick, my guys, they went to this school, and I just wanted to be them. You know, I just wanted to be those guys. Marcus Williams, Big Marcus, Little Marcus, Chico, kids I went to Audubon with. And, you know, the football coach, Coach Garrick, was my PE teacher at Audubon. He became the football coach. And he chided me for a long time, man. Laughed, you know, he used to call me Westchester. He'd say, Westchester. Because I live right here. I could hear that bell ring every day. And my mom literally made me get up, walk from here to Slauson and Crenshaw to get on the Slauson bus to go to Westchester High School, which wasn't bad, don't get me wrong, but it wasn't like I lived in this hood. And the stories you heard about Crenshaw was like, oh my God, it was gangs and this and that. I live here every day. Like, I walk to school in this neighborhood from 2nd Ave all the way here. It's probably about 13 boys, and it's crazy, man, because it's like only like 3 or 4 of us living today. And it's wild. But my mom wanted me to get out of this neighborhood to go to school over there when I went to Audubon, and I knew everybody from over here. So it was crazy, man. But Crenshaw was like, it was crazy, man. It was like, it was where I wanted to be. And I just had that story where my mom didn't want me to go. She probably just didn't do no research of like the magnet program and what was going on. Crenshaw had always had an amazing program. And you know, things come full circle. In 2006, thanks to Coach Ed Waters and those guys, I was able to come back and be the head JV basketball coach at Crenshaw and work with the varsity basketball. And so I got a bit of the Shaw in me because of that, but because I always desired to go. I thought Stevie Thompson was, to me, Stevie was Michael Jordan. You know what I mean? That was my guy. You know, Crenshaw High was, those were my dudes. And those were the guys that I was able to look up to through all the things that was going on, man, in my life to, like, inspire to be something. Even though certain things didn't work out the way I thought it, you know, I wanted it to, or I thought it should have, those guys, you know, even Coach Garrett messing with me, Coach Willie West, Joe Weekly, Batman, and all those players, man, they helped shape who I am today just from their actions. And I had a great time with David Carter when he was the head basketball coach at University of Nevada. I was able to, you know, be an intricate part in sending some basketball players to his way. And I did it just because he was a positive role model. Not even knowing my name or even knowing me, I knew who he was coming from this neighborhood, going to St. Mary's University. And I followed those guys. Like, I followed what they did and where they went. Didn't know how to do it, didn't know how to get there, but I did. So I just think, you know, it was good, man. But this was it, man. Every day, South Central, you know, the palm trees, man. This is crazy. This is bananas.